What am I going to get with 3.0? It's a bit of an overhaul here.
Thank you so much, and thanks for having me on. Excited to be back here. So 3.0 is a bunch of different things. The main thing is that we're evolving video from being kind of a static broadcast format, right? You record it once, and everybody essentially watches the exact same version of that video. Into video that's conversational, and we're launching this new product called Video Agents, where you're going to be able to create your videos like you've always created your videos, but then you can insert these agents at different points in your video, and they can serve different purposes. If you're doing a training video, for example, you can have an agent that actually checks if the person watching the video has understood the content. If you're doing recruiting, for example, you could have an agent that interviews, gives a case study to a candidate that's kind of on the spot. So it moves video away from being static to something that's much more dynamic and conversational. And then in the wake of that, we're also launching a whole bunch of new features to just make the core product better. So launching a new co-pilot, making it easier for people to create video in a chat style interface, launching new avatar technologies where you can take and prompt new avatars into existence. You can take the avatar that you already have of yourself, and you can say, hey, I want to be on a boat, I want to be in a corporate office, I want to change my outfit. And it certainly just opens up a whole bunch of new creative possibilities.
New possibilities at a time where we're questioning the effectiveness of these AI agents and indeed adoption within enterprise, Victor. Just talk to us about how you've been talking to your customers. We've had the MIT report saying 95% of pilots aren't working. How is it working within your clients?
We've always had this mantra called utility over novelty. You know, we've always said technology is amazing and it's cool, and of course it's what we build our company around. But ultimately, we have to solve a problem for the end customer, right? And I think that the MIT report is pretty bang on. In my own personal experience, I think that like 80% of AI tools today simply just don't work. 15% of them kind of stumble their way there, and the last 5% actually work. When you look at our business and I think the kind of numbers that we're delivering, it's very clear that our product really truly works. We increased our NRR to 142% from up 13% from 12 months ago. We have, you know, four times as many customers paying us more than 100K than we did 12 months ago. And all these things only happen because people actually get value out of the product, right? Now, I think what we've discovered at Synthesia is that as important as the models are, right, like, of course, generating the avatars, generating these, like, video clips for people is really important. But ultimately, it's about a workflow. Why do you make a video? You make a video because you want to communicate something to someone. What we spent the last couple of years building out is a platform that helps you with that entire process. You create the video, you edit it in this PowerPoint sort of style interface, you collaborate with your colleagues, you have content management, translation, we have a publishing platform with our own video player. And so what we've managed to do is to take that process and make it as quickly as we can.
You quantified the market for these tools and gave numbers on those that you feel don't work, and we as a team can go away and check that math. But for Synthesia 3.0, do you have some benchmarking data that is evidence of its performance and capability against the large field that is text to video?
Well, I think the way you benchmark these things depends very much on the use case, right? If I'm creating a training video, that's a very different benchmark than creating a marketing video, for example. I think what we've seen very clearly, like, you know, 3.0, a lot of these things, we're literally releasing them as we go right now. So they haven't, you know, been in the market for 12 months. But what we see is that if you're doing training content, for example, engagement is increased by 30% versus sharing that as normal text. There's a benchmark against other text-to-video tools. What we're really good at is avatars. That's the thing that we deeply care about. We're now integrating other models as well. So if you want to use VO3 in the product, you can use that. We're adding a bunch of other models as well. So I think for us as a company, I don't really think it makes sense to benchmark us against text to video tools, you know. For us, it's about the process of communicating something to someone. And that goes much deeper than just the models themselves.
This week, the big focus has been on Meta's Vibes. Funny name, and the reporting that OpenAI is looking at a video tool in conjunction with being a social media platform. You've been on this program and discussed, you know, the risks of AI-generated video content in social media domains. But what's your reaction to those two moves by those two players?
I think it's very predictable. I'm quoted, you know, I think 4 or 5 years ago in a book saying that I think by 2026, 95% of all content on the internet is going to be AI generated. I think that's where we're moving towards. Now, it feels odd, it feels weird, I think, that we're going to be watching AI generated content. But I think, you know, ultimately will care less about how something was produced, will care more about the content in itself. A lot of the content people make with AI today is what most people would call slop, right? It's not very high quality. It's kind of like engagement farming, engagement baiting. But I think that'll eventually be replaced by people using these tools to create awesome content. There's so many great creators on the internet. They'll pick up these tools and they'll use them to create great content. As for the big platforms moving into this space, I think, again, highly predictable. These companies ultimately make their money off ads, right? And to launch an ad in one of these networks, you want that to be video in 2025 because that performs way better. And these platforms, they want to offer you the tools to make those videos for those ads, right? Which is exactly like Google owning the platform to create AdWords for search engine marketing, for example. So I think it's very predictable they're going to move into this space. I think it's also predictable that they're going to offer these tools inside their apps. You know, it feels new maybe that they're adding AI video, but really they've been doing this for 6-7 years, you know, like putting dog ears on yourself with face filters. All this stuff is roughly the same technology, right? So I think it's just it's just like this sort of trajectory of, you know, more and more AI being part of the content creation flows, both in our personal lives, but also very much in our corporate lives.
And boy, am I getting Sora 2 made videos coming my way. And the standalone app has been announced just yesterday, Victor. But I'm interested in your story with, at the moment, avatars are being liked by NVIDIA, no less. We said that you're already backed by NVIDIA and Adobe. Jensen's just went on stage last week in the UK saying he's going to get into your next round. When's that next funding round happening?
Time will show. You know, we're very appreciative of Jensen and our NVIDIA partnership. And I think, if anything, for us at Synthesia, it's a testament to the fact that we drive so much real value for our client that we're way past the kind of demo stage. I think, you know, we're well capitalized. We raised a bunch of funding rounds. Who knows when the next one is going to come. But, you know, we've given Jensen our word that he'll get to participate in it.